and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and our arts calendar. For our cinema portion of the program, Cinema One, we present Open Society and a conversation with Mickey Dickoff, who is the director and producer of Neshoba. We then proceed to State of Affairs One, a conversation with Alinka Seth, human rights activist, Brenda Dixon Gottschild, professor from Temple University. We then proceed to Vincent Thomas, also a professor from the United States, Towson University. And last but not least, Patras Vanze, human rights activist from here in Berlin. Last but not least, Cinema 2, we have Ralph Bunche, An American Odyssey, director, the distinguished William Greaves. So in addition to staying cool, remember you are participating in what else but The Collegium.
Bailando cuando
An open society. An open society provides decision makers individually and collectively with the opportunity and responsibility to provide egalitarian access to a society's resources, which are beneficial towards addressing the needs of its people. The requirements of all societies should also and significantly include the history of each group, which is preserved and presented through print, media, institutional, and oral resources. One of the traditional forms of presentation is the annual celebration of historical holidays through an ongoing structure. The preservation and presentation of historical contributions is a treasured resource, which facilitates the cohesiveness, appreciation, and development of all societies, and contributes to the foundation for future generations. One such champion of contributors to an open society is Dr. Carter G. Woodson, founder of the annual and international Black History Month, which informs the celebrated people and societies of the historical contributions of said people and serves as an impetus in supporting and encouraging the continued development and preservation of cultural history. We wish to thank the scholars who have historically contributed specialized knowledge in many disciplines in association with Dr. Carter G. Woodson. Thank you for your gifts to world culture and civilization. Hello and welcome to a special edition of The Collegium here at the Rathaus Schöneberg during the 25th Black International Cinema Berlin 2010. And we're very pleased to be joined by the filmmaker Mickey Dickoff. Mickey, welcome to The Collegium.
It's an honor to be here and thank you for inviting me.
Mickey, in viewing your film, I think that it has some very important ramifications, not only for the United States, but worldwide. Tell us about the principles of your film and how we can bring a universal aspect to it.
Well, the film really is about using truth as a groundwork for racial healing, justice, forgiveness, and all those issues that are important to us. And it's sort of like what happened in South Africa. You know, if we could have truth and reconciliation commissions and really tell the truth and really get the poison out of the wound, then that's how we move on. So whether it's about civil rights in the United States or racial issues anywhere or any kind of issues where discrimination rears its ugly head, if we can tell the truth, even if it's painful, then we can move on. I mean, the price of freedom has never been free, and we have to make people understand that. We need to understand our history so that we don't repeat it again.
Mickey, when you talk about telling the truth, in your opinion, why is it so difficult for the truth to be told?
Well, because the truth is painful, and sometimes there's very ugly things that happened in our world, and sometimes it's easier for people to put it under the rug. But if we put it under the rug, then we don't heal. And so I think it's really important that we tell the truth, even though it may be hurtful.
With the film that you've made, what would you consider would be the psychological subtext?
Well, I think the psychological subtext would have to do with the fact that individual people can make a difference. And I think that what I hope the film does is that these three young men and the hundreds of other young people who gave their lives for the right to vote, that will inspire other young people that we can all make a difference and do something. We all have to carry our weight. We all have to do our share. And that's what I hope the film will do.
These three young men, whom we will talk about in a few moments, they are a metaphor for many young people who have found themselves, shall we say, in extremely difficult positions in various parts of the world in various times in history because they try to address their beliefs.
Right. And, you know, those three kids went down to Mississippi not thinking they were going to get murdered. Okay, they went down there because of their own passion and their own beliefs in equality of human beings, okay? And so when they went down there, they had no idea they were going to make this kind of change, that they were going to give the ultimate, and that was their lives. I remember Mrs. Goodman saying, you know, my son didn't give his life was taken from him. And that's really, really true. So sometimes we don't know what it is we're going to do. But what's important is that we do it. I hope we don't have to all give our lives for that. But sometimes it might even be worth it for that, if it can make such a big change in the world. And Janie Goodman and Schwerner, they really made a change in the world. Of course, they only made the change is because two of them are white. And so it took two white people to get killed in the civil rights movements when prior to that, hundreds of people had been killed. But whatever it takes, that's what it takes. And I think that what we need to do is inspire young people, teach young people that they can go out and make that difference, and I hope my film does that.
How did these three young men come together?
Mickey Schwerner had been in Mississippi for 6 months before Freedom Summer. He was a 24-year-old social worker. He was introduced to James Chaney, and so they became friends. It was very rare for a black and white person to be friends at that time, and they really cared about one another. 6 months later, a thing called Freedom Summer was going to happen. It was started by the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And what they wanted to do is they wanted to bring students in from the North, mostly white kids in from the North, to help register black folks to vote because they felt that white people wouldn't get hurt. Although I'll tell you the truth, some of them thought white people might get hurt, and that's how they would get attention. So those three kids went down there to do the right thing, and they were there one day before the Ku Klux Klan murdered them in cold blood, bragged about it. We knew it was the sheriff, the deputy sheriff, the Baptist preacher, it was the lawyer, the doctor, and the businessman. And I think the thing that upset me the most was not only that they were murdered, which was horrible, but the fact everybody knew who did it and nobody did anything about it.
Mickey, explain to me then, when these fellows, I'm sure, considered themselves good, upstanding Christian men, how then do they justify that sort of behavior, Mickey?
Well, if you saw the film, you can see the Bible is used quite a lot. As a matter of fact, the ringleader, the mastermind of the murders, is a Baptist minister. Now, how anybody can believe in Jesus Christ and think it's okay to kill anybody for what reason, it's really hard to fathom, but what they do is they use the Bible to justify, you know, that it's okay to do those things. I mean, in the Bible, black people are mud people or whatever. So they take the Bible, they bastardize the Bible, and then they get the poor, ignorant people to believe the same thing that they're believing. And that's why it's so insidious, because Jesus would never, never condone any kind of violence.
Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Yeah. How well educated are these men in your film, in general, those kinds of people? And what is the relationship between their education or lack thereof and their interest in the Bible?
Okay, well, the Klansmen that I met, including Edgar A. Killen, you know, have barely a high school education, okay? So maybe if they were more educated, you know, they would learn something differently. But I think it's a direct relationship between ignorance and using the Bible to justify what it is that you're trying to do. So I think ignorance plays a big part. As a matter of fact, the way we combat ignorance is through education.
All right. Tell us about the film. I mean, it's entitled Neshoba. Why is that the title?
Well, it's actually called Neshoba, The Price of Freedom. Neshoba was the county where the three young men were murdered in 1964. And, you know, people may not know what that means before they see the movie, but I will tell you that after they see the movie, they will never forget the word Neshoba.
Why, in your opinion, say in 1964 or even prior, why was that part of the United States so destitute in terms of human relations?
Well, you have to understand there was a great big, huge black population in the South. And what were they afraid of? What happened in 2008 with Barack Obama becoming president. And so they had to keep people disenfranchised, because if you have a huge black population, it's about 50% of Mississippi, and you give them the right to vote, all of a sudden you may have some black folks being in powerful places. And so that's, they just had to keep blacks uneducated and from voting. But obviously, it didn't work.
Mickey, what is the relationship between that and the Haitian independence, in your opinion?
Well, they're pretty similar now, aren't they? it doesn't really matter if it happens in the United States, or it happens in Haiti, or it happens in Germany, or where it happens. It's all the same powerful people trying to infringe their rights on the poor, on the people that don't have, the have-nots, let's put it that way, the have-nots.
Okay, for our audience, tell us about your film, The Beginning, the Middle, and the End.
Well, the film starts out by giving you an overview of what happened, but the film is really about Mississippi today. It's about racism in 2004, but you can't talk about racism in 2004 until you look back 40 years ago and see from whence it came. It was very important to tell this story, because none of the perpetrators were ever held accountable. And I know what my mommy and daddy told me, if I did something wrong, that I have to be held accountable, okay? And Lord knows I didn't murder anybody, okay? So it's offensive. It's absolutely offensive for people to brag about killing people. And they didn't just kill them. You know, they killed them and buried them in a dam, thinking nobody had ever seen them. And of course, they not only killed the two white kids, they tortured the black kid, because they have to be better than somebody else. And so, that's what we have to really look at. We have to take the masks off of people. We have to see beyond color. We have to see beyond religion. We have to see the internal parts of ourselves. We have to be the change we want us to, that Barack Obama talks about. We have to do that. And, I've been doing it for 35 years, and I hope that young people will continue to do that. And us oldsters, too. We have an obligation to this society to make it a better place for our children. And right now, at least in my country, the kids are in terrible trouble. They pay prison guards in my country $65,000 a year, but school teachers, they pay $30,000 a year. Well, you got a problem when prison guards are making more money than school teachers, and then you're wondering why we have so much violence. Or so many people doing drugs. We need to help our children, and we really don't do that, because if you keep, especially kids living in poverty, the vicious cycle keeps repeating itself. And they actually, I think some of the kids actually internalize the failure. Well, I'm not going to make it, so of course I'll fail. And that's a major problem.
And when the film ends, what message or what point of view is it bringing to the audience, Mickey?
Well, at the end, we talk about the only way to heal is to tell the truth, and I think that's really what the film talks about. But I wanted to make it very clear that although those three kids gave their lives and died, that there were so many others that nobody ever heard about. So at the end of our film, we do an homage. Now, these are only 125 names that I could find and verify. I know there's a lot more, okay, but I know those are verifiable names. We need to let people know that those kids had mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters and wives, and we can't let it go. We need to be able to talk about it. And one of the things, to me, the most important part of my film is that roll at the end. I knew that I was going to put that roll at the end before I shot one frame, because it wasn't just about these two white kids, okay? It was about something larger than that. And you know what? Most people don't know about that. And when they see those names, I think that's the most powerful part of the film, because people have no sense what the price of freedom cost.
Mickey, there's some growing tensions in the United States, shall we say, some very dissatisfied people. How can your film help these people to better understand themselves, the situation they're in, and perhaps find another route other than the rather perhaps destructive path they're taking?
Well, they have to want to do it, you see. And if you don't have the desire to make change, you're not going to make change. And as Ben Cheney says in my film, it may take another 40 or 50 years for some of those old guys to die, because you know what? They're not going to change. But we can get to the kids. Even Cecil Price was the deputy sheriff who was directly involved in the murders. His son is a different person. His son went to school with black kids. His best friend is a black man. Okay, so things are changing. It's just we have to give it time, and we have to educate people that we can make that change.
But when I read about some of the developments in the school districts in the United States, I'm not exactly sure that I read about the opportunities for children from different backgrounds to be together. How does that work, Mickey?
That's what you and I and all the people have to try to help that. I'm making a new film about three generations of a black family in Houston, where that cycle of poverty, drugs, prison, gangs, and death keeps repeating itself, okay? And the focus is on the third generation of this family, on 9, 10, and 11-year-old kids. And you know what? They have to be saved. And the way they're going to be saved is by people mentoring them, people loving them, and people talking about the value of education. And I think that a lot of times that does not happen, and particularly in impoverished communities, because they're so attuned to failure. They're taught all the time they're going to fail, that they actually sometimes think that school's not a good thing. That's why they join gangs. Or we don't have mommies and daddies. Certainly daddies aren't available most of the time, okay? So it goes back to the family, it goes back to the church, it goes back to education, and it goes back to some of us mentoring young people. It doesn't take a whole hell of a lot, to tell you the God's honest truth.
We went.
Hello and welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program, where we're very pleased to be joined by a very distinguished panel. To my right is Alinka Seth. To my left, Brenda Dixon Gottschild. To my right again in the corner, Vincent Thomas. To my left in the corner, Patras Vanze. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Collegium.
Thank you.
I'll start with the ladies first. I'm very interested to know, why are you here in Berlin with you?
Why am I here? my husband is a Berliner.
Okay.
We are both performers, professionals. We have family and professional connections here. So we come to Berlin regularly.
Okay.
In fact, it almost feels like a vacation until I begin to see the things that are going on and begin to involve myself in them. For example, meeting Donald Muldrow Griffith.
Thank you. Thank you. Alinka, what about your activities here in Berlin? Tell us about your work.
Yeah, I came to Berlin in 1980. First, I lived in Munich, Bavaria. Mm-hmm. And 1980 happened something made me very sad. And there has been a terrible crime on the Oktoberfest, a bombing attack. And I couldn't understand why this party went on, that nobody stopped it. Mm-hmm. And another thing happened, I couldn't find another flat. We have been there as a community in one flat, mostly students, but also people who are working. And we have had to go out because our flat has been sold. And so I was looking for another flat but didn't find it, and so I went to Berlin.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good. Patras, tell us about your background, your Berlin experiences.
Yeah, it's quite interesting. First of all, I'm really very thankful for my invitation here. And to be with you this evening. I would like to respond to your question. As you said, we have to say why we are here with you. Yeah, we are here because of different reasons.
Exactly.
But specifically, I myself am here because I am not happy with the German government, EU government, African government, as well as worldwide. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm here right now in Europe and Germany today and Berlin today. So, specifically, I'm living in the protest camp, Oranienplatz, Berlin, protesting for our rights. We want the German government to respond positively to our demands. Mm. We are demanding the German government to stop deportation. We are demanding the German government to abolish resident fleet. We are demanding the German government to close all lagers and respect the freedom of movement, because we believe that freedom of movement is everybody's right. As long as we human beings are concerned, unless the German government and its her counterparts, they don't believe that other people are human beings.
Okay. Vincent, when you hear what he said, tell us about why you're here in Berlin and what are your experiences in the country that you come from
that might in some way, shape, or form relate to the issues that he's raising.
That's deep and full. I'll begin by saying that I'm an artist, an educator, and above that, a breathing human being who is compassionate and curious about the well-being of humanity. And so what brought me to Berlin was this curiosity about the city, the people, the arts, and knowing that through arts there is a powerful agent of change. So that was my bleeding curiosity in coming here. Yeah.
Well, while you're thinking about that, let me ask you, Brenda. The gentleman used a very interesting term. He said, we demand from the German government certain resources, certain responses. How does that work? In your opinion, is it a demand or a request? Which approach is most likely to achieve their goals? Mm-hmm. I think about the situation to some extent, it reminds me in Egypt that's currently going on with demands of the Muslim Brotherhood. And it's come to certain unfortunate circumstances. How do you handle this situation to get what you want from a situation and circumstances that are more powerful than you? How do you approach that?
Well, obviously, it's about very specific issues, and I think the kind of response that you need has to be extremely specific. It has to be culturally and socially and politically parametered by what's happening there. I can't, obviously, I mean, not Obama, not anybody can really figure out at this point how to relate to what's happening in Egypt. But let me just go back to the first part of your question where you talked about the difference between like a demand and a request. And one way that we could think about that is when we see what was happening with the Wall Street movement. And I spoke at another time with Alinka about movements like that, similar to that in the immigrant community here, in the community of people here who are trying to figure out what to do. It's like, when do you need to move from a request to the place where Patras is now, which is, and where the community is now, which is a demand? And I think that that is very culturally and at this point specific to what's happening in this place at this time, when you see that your requests are not being respected. And I think respect is a big thing in there. When your requests are not being respected, when you have no other recourse except, especially when your movement is delimited. In a case like that, then, and or for example, in terms of what was happening for employment with people in America, which started the Wall Street movement, that when you reach the wall, you know, when you reach the ceiling, the glass ceiling, maybe it doesn't look like it's really a ceiling, but you keep butting up against it, that's when the request becomes a demand.
Okay. Alinka, there's a situation where that we have to compare. If you talk about a request and a demand, now in order to have the possibilities to realize either, what is the relationship to that to having a strategy? What is the strategy or the plan by which one may or a group may have the possibilities to realize from a more powerful force either a request or a demand? Are they prepared to really make either one? Is the strategy there? They may have the right to do it, but in terms of the right in dealing with politics, is the plan in order so that they have a chance to achieve their goals.
It is very interesting. Refugee struggle is working on a level of civil disobedience, but very powerful, and so is inspiring more people to work on the level of civil disobedience too. Mm-hmm. And I think we have to build up associations, and everybody should look where is a place in the society, and which possibilities he has or she has to struggle for human rights, you know. Yesterday we had a demonstration of Lampedusa people, and they escaped from Libya by boat because of the war in 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And it has been a terrible situation for the sub-Saharians in Libya. Mm-hmm. Because first a German weapon, Heckler and Koch, were in the hands of soldiers of Gaddafi, and they shot the rebels and also sub-Saharians, and afterwards the rebels took the weapon and shot sub-Saharians too, because they said that they were soldiers of Gaddafi, but it was not true for the most of them. Mm-hmm. And so they had to flee. And I think we have, this is my position, I will now start to organize a women's struggle against militarism, the production of weapons, and to stay at the side of refugees, and also because Bashir yesterday said we all have to struggle and fight for peace. And when we look to Egypt and Syria and all the other states, the Arab states in Africa, on the continent Africa, they are overflooded by weapons.
Yes.
And and this is a
as is the USA.
Patras,
I was thinking about what Professor Brenda was just saying, and also what Alinka was saying, and it's. And my mind goes back to the question about request, demand, mm-hmm. and the impact of those words, where it feels as though request is all good intentions of this extension of hand, mm-hmm. and but the demand, there hasn't been. It gets to a point where the listening is not there, the listening for understanding and not debate, and to know that multiple truths reside in the same place possibly. Mm-hmm. So there's an empathetic way of listening that possibly the government has not, may not have done. So that was just ringing and surfacing for me. Mm-hmm. As I was listening to yes.
Well, there's an interesting situation. We go back to the request and demand. When the people talk about sub-Saharan Africa and the relationship between the people there when they were in Libya,
yeah.
Now, things were a little bit difficult for sub-Saharan people there also, even before what happened to Gaddafi.
Yeah.
When Gaddafi was executed,
yes.
And Libya, of course, is in very much disarray now, similar to Iraq.
Yeah.
The situation in terms of the difficulty for the so-called sub-Saharan people or dark-skinned people from another part of Africa became even worse from what I've read. Demanding that the people, when they could, had to leave to go somewhere. Somewhere happened to be Europe, mm-hmm. Italy, Lampedusa. If I understand the situation correctly, from there, the Italian government gave a certain number of them, I think it was 500 euro, mm-hmm. and deported them to Hamburg, Germany. Take it from there. Where are we? How's that for interesting?
Yeah, it's quite interesting and somehow a laughable matter, but also annoying matter. First of all, I would like us to go back on the issue of requesting and demanding something. For you, what does it really mean? If I demand something, it means I possess something. Request, it means I have nothing. So I have to beg you. But in terms of politics now, if we say the German government must, we mean it. It's time now to take our freedom back. We have it. But it was violated. And it, which is the process, it is still continuing. It began long time ago by colonialism.
Yes, yeah.
Then post-colonialism.
Which continues until today.
Corruption as being their catalyst. It works as a catalyst in this game. So, for me, if I demand, or if I say I demand the German government, the European states, or the African states, or worldwide, to respect human dignity. I mean to take my rights back.
Why, when you demand something, especially in politics, there's usually what they call the quid pro quo. What does the German government get or receive from giving you your rights? Where's the trade-off? How do you work that out, Andres?
I think when we talk about German, the way now, right now, I understand German, it is quite interesting. Because before I left my country, I knew that German, not only being among the G so-called country or superpower, but also I knew that it's among the countries in Europe which is democratic. But my presence here disproved me.
That democratic for some, but not necessarily.
You know?
Yeah.
First, Germany might be unique from other EU member states. Because mostly if you look at the politics or the way the structure of the German government, how it is constructed, you may see that 90% it was constructed on racism. So in such a racist state, it is really, really very difficult for them to understand what the innocent people struggling for their rights mean.
Patrice, what is the relationship, and then I come to you, Alenka, what is the relationship between the possibilities for people from other countries settling in Germany, which is for many years said it is not an immigrant country. Now, when you look at the census reports and the demographic reports, you see not only in Germany, but in many European countries, that there are not being enough babies produced. That means in the future, they're going to need people from somewhere. What is the relationship between demonstrating to this government and other governments that perhaps as a result of them needing human beings in order to maintain the society economically and socially, that it might be to their advantage to allow the people to come in here, train them, and prepare them to support the structures of the country for the future. Would that work, in your opinion? And then I want to ask you, Aleka, your opinion. Go ahead.
And I'd like to put in something.
Oh, cool, you're good. First, second, third.
I think if you think deep, I think they don't need this help. Mm-hmm. Because on the ground, what is going on? What is in practice? Mm-hmm.
But that's similar to Mandela, though, wasn't it, in South Africa?
Yeah.
A lot of times the people can't see. They have eyes, but they can't see, and ears, but they can't hear. So how do we find the means by which we make the people much more sensitive and conscious to their needs? Because it seems to me that you have a vision that could be very useful to the country. Yeah. But we have to find the way, or you have to find the way, or we have to find the way to bring that vision forward and bring an understanding to the people of the contributions that you and other people are in a position to make. Well, I mean, what do you think?
Yeah, exactly. I think we need a sensitization.
Cool. Aleka, how do you respond to it? And then I'm coming to you.
Yeah, I think we have to find goals for many people who are suffering about this system and the brutality. And so we all need good food, good livelihood conditions, homes, and we have to talk and communicate what we need for our children, for our future, for really a human being, you know. Mm-hmm. And so we can have the chance to transform also the economy, that we find out, oh, this is not so good for a human being, it's not so healthy, let us take this, or let's educate the children better, and let's stop all production of weapon, but take the resources for needs, as a, for example, I say, make tanks, Panzer in German, for waffle irons. This is good, you can make good food with it.
Let me ask then, is there,
if you, can I just two people,
yeah, no, I'm coming
slip
to you.
It in.
What
yeah.
is the relationship between what they're discussing and the issue with the Mexicans in the United States and the so-called immigration reform? Is there similarities between what you're hearing these people describe about what's going on here and what may be happening in the United States? I'll go there and then I'll come to you.
I think there is some similarity. Of course, the degree of similarity and impact is there. And you know, I will be the first to say I'm not as up on the mm-hmm. on that as I, even though I'm from the States, I'm not as up on that. But I do feel the sentiment and the impact there as being similar with the immigrants there.
Okay.
Just to say again about specificity and how, like, you know, each place kind of makes its own architecture, if you will. This question about what Patras had so eloquently said about the difference between demand and respect. You know,
yes.
at some point you're going to be a politician. You're going to be in somebody's parliament, okay? Mm. You should be, okay? But you know that actually Germans are being financed to have kids. So right. that in a sense, that kind of
which Germans?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, which
that,
Germans?
Caucasian Germans are being financed, that if you have another kid, you will be supported, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera. So that is to kind of put a wedge into mm-hmm. this possibility of others filling the need. And just to add on to that, but that's why when you're finally up against the wall, you have to do what happened in the civil rights era in the United States, which is, that's what you're saying. There were people who wore signs that said, "I am a man," if you'll remember. At some point you say, "I can't take this." And indeed, like the march that was here yesterday. Mm. I can't take this. I am a human being. This is a human demand that I'm making. Mm-hmm. And it becomes a movement.
Yeah. Well, the interesting thing about that, though, I mean, when you go back to the people like Martin Luther King and people like that, mm-hmm. they still sat with the Kennedys and Johnson to discuss the strategies by which this situation might work. In other words, the pressures were there, and the media picked that up. Well, now, the politicians do not necessarily like that kind of negative public relations. So they saw, particularly with the discussions that were going in the background, they saw that how they could discuss with Johnson and other people to set about some certain rights that were then given as a result of the pressures. So it's more than a one-pronged strategy. The other thing is about the children that are the payment from the government. They, from the statistics that they're being put out, they're still not enough.
No,
they're paying
definitely
them,
not.
So that's still not working.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
yeah.
The approach of pointing out to the people that we have something, or other people from other countries have something to contribute to the society, that we are not only just parasites. Mm-hmm. Quite often the media does not present, in other education, right. does not present right. a broad enough picture of what the possibilities are. This will take time to get the people to do it, because you have, like they had in South Africa, there are many people who want to hold back the dawn, even though it is inevitable. But for those who can see, it is inevitable that things will change.
Yeah.
You're on the right track.
Yeah,
so go ahead.
I'm reminded of Fannie Lou Hamer saying, "I'm tired of being sick. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired."
Uh-huh.
And that just resonates so much when I think about these two words now, request and demand.
Yeah.
Because I can see it and feel it in Petrus, that place of being against that wall, and you as well, being against, and where do you go from there?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What is next?
Yes. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us here on the Collegium. It's been a splendid conversation, and I look forward to sharing this with a wider audience, which I think should stimulate a debate, should stimulate some thinking about some of the issues that all of you, this distinguished panel, have validly raised.
Stimulating conversation and dialogue.
And I cannot stop. I think we have to continue it.
Yeah.
Yes.
The conversation is merely a step that is accompanied by strategic planning and exercise. That's how it works.
Yeah.
And patience and discipline and a vision. And people prepared to sacrifice to make the things happen that they want to happen.
Yeah.
So stay with us. And remember, you are participating in what else but La Collegium.
Сам президент признал, Гертер признал, вся Америка признала, что да.
To the Soviets at the height of the Cold War, Ralph Bunche was simply a tool of the West.
In this fight to clean out the disloyal people, the bad security risks from the State Department.
To some Americans, on the other hand, he was an undercover agent for the Soviets.
And the last thing we have to do is to build a power base so strong in this country that will bring them to their knees.
During the turbulent 60s, some militant black Americans saw him as an international Uncle Tom. But to the vast majority of his fellow citizens of all colors, Bunche was nothing less than the ultimate model Negro. The person behind the image projected by the media of the day was far more complex and fascinating than even Bunch himself cared to reveal. Even today, he remains an enigma in American and world history. Bunch may have symbolized world peace and intergroup harmony, but he was no stranger to conflict and controversy. Today, across the street from the United Nations headquarters in New York, in a pocket-sized park, a towering monument celebrates the work of Ralph Bunch. Peace Form One. Ralph Johnson Bunch, an African-American mediator, successfully negotiates an armistice agreement between Israel and four Arab nations, Transjordan, Lebanon, Egypt, and Syria. The only time in the long history of the Arab-Israeli conflict that all four Arab nations signed a peace treaty with Israel. Throughout the world, there is great hope for lasting peace in the Holy Land. For this unprecedented feat, Ralph Bunch is awarded a Nobel Prize for Peace and is catapulted into worldwide celebrity. Less well known, but more significant and longer lasting, is the role he played behind the scenes in the historic struggle for self-determination after World War II. A struggle in which over a billion people of color gained national independence. How did a black man in America in the 1950s attain such an important level of influence in global affairs?
We ran a story in Ebony saying that Ralph Bunch was the most honored black man. We said Negro, don't. Most honored black man in the world. I think he was the first black man to become a crossover in something other than entertainment. We probably have a bigger file on Ralph Bunch than we have on Michael Jackson.